Pokemon movies. There sure are a lot of them, 21 to be exact. And when a franchise has that many films, you know there's gonna be a huge variety in the quality. Either that or they're just all bad. And as someone who's seen all of them, except that new one since I don't live in Japan, I decided that I'm gonna rate them all from worst to best. I'll give a brief description of each movie, along with one of 5 ratings. So here we go, in 3, 2, 1. With obvious voice acting problems aside, this film was bad. Like really, really, really bad. The Genesect are attacking people, for some reason, and it's up to Mewtwo to put a stop to this, for some reason. You know, a little explanation would have been pretty nice. Also, action companies serve literally no purpose to the plot, like, at all. When I first saw that there would be a movie starring this many legendary Pokemon, I was so excited. Then it actually came out. And it was awful. Most of this film is just watching the legendaries do Hoopa's bidding, and the rest is dedicated to bad exposition. And did anyone else notice that Lugia just kinda disappears halfway through? This film thinks futuristic cube technology makes it look cool, and it's wrong. There's a kid who's scared of Pokemon, then he isn't, and then he is again, and then he isn't again. Jeez, the Sun and Moon anime did this trope better, and that is definitely not a good thing. Also, Deoxys and Rayquaza are at war or something along those lines. Keldeo has to defeat Kyurem to officially become a Sword of Justice. Why exactly does it have to fight Kyurem? To sell Black and White 2, that's why. Kyurem then gets really angry and attacks a random city. For little to no reason. Oh yeah, and also Ash is there. For little to no reason. Look, I grew up with this movie, so it'll always have some nostalgic value to me. Critically, however, this one seriously blew. A guy named Zero's got a lot of cool tech, and he really wants Giratina. For reasons. However, he never feels like a real threat. On a villain scale, he's a big ol' Zero. I'm sorry. Also, I feel like this is the movie where telepathy went too far, cause I see no good reason why Shaman should be talking. So why exactly did they make 2 separate movies? I mean, isn't one enough? And which one exactly is canon? Or are neither of them canon? So many questions I know I'm never gonna get the answer to. Also, this movie's plot doesn't really make any sense. But hey, at least Victini's cute, and thank god it doesn't talk. When I think of a mediocre Pokemon movie, this is the first one that always comes to mind. It's not a bad film, but there's just nothing special about it. I mean, there's a carnival, and Team Magma's kind of in the movie, and the focus is on little annoying Max. Why? Also, this film thinks I'm okay with Groudon having tentacles. I am not okay with it. You'll enjoy this one just as long as you don't think too hard about the plot. But it does deal with time travel, so paradoxes galore. I do really like the setting of this movie. Something about an ancient Pokemon world just seems really cool to me. But for a supposed god, Arceus is really childish. What's this? It looks like Pokemon decided to redo Jirachi Wishmaker, but this time make it slightly better. This one's still not amazing by any means, but it does show just how much Mei has grown since the start of her journey. But that whole ending with the Sea Crown and the King of the Sea is just so dumb. However, as an ad for a spin-off game, this film could have been a lot worse. You know, I really like the first hour of this movie. Then Marshadow becomes evil for some reason, and Pikachu talks. What do you mean, I always want to be with you? You hated Ash at the beginning of the film, and still wouldn't go inside your Pokeball. Either this one's really weird, or that was definitely not butter in the popcorn. But you can't argue that the animation in this one was downright stunning. I always thought this one just kind of feels dull. Maybe it's the fact that none of the Pokemon in this film are really that exciting. Or maybe it's because Sammy, aka Young Professor Oak, is just not that interesting of a character. But the story really isn't bad, and whenever I see this villain, I can't help but laughing. I mean, just look at this guy. This movie seems like a mixed bag with fans, and I can definitely see why. It does sort of feel like an extended episode of the show, and most of the characters really aren't that exciting. That being said, it does have a really nice story, and Volcanion's reunion with Magearna at the end is pretty heartwarming. Throw in Ash Greninja and, for some reason, perfect form Zygarde, and you've got the recipe for an exciting film, but not necessarily an amazing one. This movie did so much right, and I mean so much. We've got interesting characters, a gripping story, and some pretty creepy scenes for a Pokemon movie. I especially love how Darkrai is portrayed in this film. However, there are some pretty major faults with this one. While most of the characters are interesting and serve purpose to the story, some can be pretty annoying at times, especially Baron Alberto. Not to mention the amount of BS in that final scene was enough to make my head explode. Mewtwo is honestly one of the most interesting and fleshed out characters in the entire series. plus the creepy sci-fi setting actually fits this film's tone really well. And honestly, my biggest complaint isn't even the film's fault, but rather that 4Kids cut out Amber's story from the beginning of the movie. This short was eventually released in the West as part of the Mewtwo Returns DVD, and it was titled The Uncut Story of Mewtwo's Origins, which is basically the worst name ever. But trust me, Ash's revival will make a lot more sense if you watch the short. From the first film right into the second one. While the story is basically a simple fetch quest, the characters more than make up for it, and those scenes where Melody teases Misty are just so great, not to mention some beautiful music to tie it all together. This movie does kind of feel like an extended XY episode, and you know what? I'm actually alright with that. This isn't necessarily the most incredible or epic film, but it definitely holds up. While the villains aren't really that exciting, that all changes when he Voltal attacks. You know, the Cocoon of Destruction is a pretty fitting name, given that Xerneas had to, just to set everything right. And the best part of this movie is, Diancie is so cute that it physically hurts. While Zorua really shouldn't have telepathy, I never found it to be that annoying like it was with Shaman. But moving past that, the characters are likable, the story is great, and the animation is incredible. Also, Kodai gets bonus points as a villain. His actions all feel ruthless and threatening. He threatens to torture Zorua if Zoroark doesn't obey him, and he even threatens Ash with death in order to keep his good public image. Really shows just how much of an effect propaganda has on people. This movie gets a lot of praise, and for good reason. This is the only film where Ash and Pikachu aren't together for the most part. This makes for an interesting story as Ash and company try to rescue Pikachu. Meanwhile, Lucario had just woken up from being trapped in his staff for hundreds of years. While the story is a bit cliche with Lucario slowly beginning to trust humans, it all feels really believable. And let's not forget its sacrifice at the end, that was a tearjerker alright. This movie starts out all bright and happy, only to get super dark out of nowhere, and I honestly love it. This film focuses solely on Ash, as Misty and Brock are absent for much of it. This allows his character to really thrive as the movie puts a bigger focus on the protagonist. And the soundtrack is just so good! Honestly, this film is great in almost every possible area, but there is one that I believe is even better. And in my opinion, the all-time greatest Pokémon movie is... Detective Pikachu! That's right, this film hasn't even come out, and it's already my favorite. That's how good I know it's going to be. This film will be so good that... I'm sorry, I can't. Spell of the Unknown. No matter how much I watch this movie, it still manages to amaze me. Spell of the Unknown is not only my absolute favorite Pokemon movie, but it's also one of my all-time favorite movies, period. And sorry, Kodai, but you got beat out by a 5-year-old for best antagonist. Molly is an innocent girl who had already lost her mother. Molly then discovers the Unknown after they take her father away. They grant Molly's wish for a family, creating an Entei as a father, who later ends up kidnapping Ash's mom in order to give Molly a mother. I love this film, as Ash isn't helping someone just because he's a good person. No, this time it's personal for him, as Molly's wish for a family tears Ash's family apart. Add in an incredible soundtrack and beautiful hand-drawn animation, and you've got yourself the very best Pokemon movie. But keep in mind, this is all just my opinion. Feel free to let me know your favorites as well. Now if you'll excuse me, I've got a movie to go watch for the 100th time. Seriously, how did this come out of Pokemon of all places?